and 6 years rather, and then joined IIT in 1984.
Currently, Professor Juvekar is the L&D chair professor in our department. He has held, he has been honored with many awards, including the Hadidia Award. He has been honored as the best teacher in the department for consecutive 4 years. He has guided research in many, many sub areas of chemical engineering. Over the last 28 years, almost 25, two cricket teams have received his guidance in PhD. And M.Tech, I don't know, must be 50 or 60. With a very vast experience in chemical engineering, variety of research areas. Today, Professor Juvekar is going to give you introduction to interfacial science, collides and interfacial science.
Yeah, thank you very much. Varan, and good morning all of you. I was supposed to talk on collide and interface engineering, but I talked with Professor Mukta Tripathi. She is going to talk about nanomaterials. So in that she said she would cover collide engineering, because collides are small particles or small materials, so it can be included as part of nanomaterial. So I thought I would only cover interface engineering. It's an extremely vast area, and it overlaps all sciences, physics, chemistry, and biology. I am afraid of biology, so I will not cover topics on biology, but probably other people will be able to tell you where this interface of biology and interfacial engineering will come. So I will not talk about the research which goes on in the department. Rather, I will tell you all panoramic scenario of in interfacial engineering, what goes on in interfacial engineering. So I have divided my talk in 5 different topics. First, I will cover characteristic of interfaces. Then I talk about wetting and spreading, one of the important aspects of interfacial engineering. Then I talk about surfactant adsorption, flocculation, colloid stabilization. I will not cover colloid stabilization and flocculation rather. I will talk about coalescence, which is similar to colloid flocculation. Then I will talk about emulsions and microemulsions and foams. So these are the topics which I am going to cover. First, I will talk about characteristics of interfaces. So the interface actually is a meeting place for two or more phases. So interface is extremely thin, it is of order of nanometer thickness, but it can the property of interface is that it can affect the properties of bulk, and therefore interface has to be studied in to find out what is the its effect on the bulk. So you have interfaces between two phases. So I have here a gas liquid interface, where this is a liquid, and you can see that interface has certain amount of curvature. I will talk about why it is so. This interface is actually two dimensional. You can consider it as two dimensional because its thickness is very small. So gas liquid interface can be considered as areas or surfaces, two dimensional surfaces. So you have gas liquid, liquid liquid, and solid liquid interfaces. You can have three phase interface, in which case you can see this is a solid, liquid, and gas interface. And if you see this interface, it becomes a line, is a line meeting where three phases meet, solid, liquid, and gas. So three phase interface is a line. So you have gas liquid, 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 solid, and liquid, liquid, liquid interfaces. So they are lines with very small thickness. So one of the important characteristic of interface is that it has surface tension or interfacial tension. Surface tension where liquid and air meets, you call it surface tension. Where two liquids or two solid liquid meet, we call it interfacial tension. So more general term is interfacial tension. So we look at the bulk. The bulk, any molecule has surrounded by large number of other molecules and they balance the forces. So the force structure is kind of isotropic. So it is equal in all dimensions, all directions, so it is isotropic. And the molecule distance between the molecules are at where the energy is minimum. So they are in energy well. So molecule lie in their energy well. But if you look at interface, it becomes anisotropic, because suppose you have air water interface, one side there are no molecules or very few molecules, other side is a dense large number of molecules, high density of molecules. So there is a problem of balancing the interfacial forces. So how does nature balances the forces? It is done by shift of molecules on the surface. So molecules get shifted from their position at minimum energy. So as a result, they are in the tension. So the molecules are slightly displaced, so they are under tension. So what is, why they are in the tension? The advantage of having this molecules which are in the tension is that any molecule which goes off, there is always a net upward force to pull it back to the surface. So any molecule which it get displaced, so you have to look equilibrium in molecular as dynamical equilibrium. You should not take it as a static equilibrium. So you can have horizontal forces balancing the vertical forces. As you can see here, it is like a pulley. If you want to pull a solid from below, you pull it with a pulley. So the mechanical analogy is like a pulley. So any molecule which tries to live will be pulled back. So there is a dynamic equilibrium. So no, the molecules at the surface are immediately replaced because they are pulled back. So that is how the force balance is maintained in dynamical sense and not in static sense. So as a result, your surface is under tension. So it acts as if it is a stretched membrane, and that has lots of properties are changed of surface. For example, these are water striders which can, their weight is balanced by the forces because there is a vertical force generated when they place their feet on the water surface. The water surface get curved. So as a result, there is a vertical force generated because of this tension which balances their weight. It is important that their feet have to be not weighted by surface, by water. If they get wet, they will sink in. So it is important that they are not weighted. One of the important result of this interfacial tension is that whenever a surface is curved, you will find that there is unbalanced force, because this tension will create a, for example, this is a convex surface upward, so it will create a downward net force. And to balance this, there is a pressure difference. So the pressure here tries to create a force which balances this downward force. So pressure PL becomes greater than PG. On the other hand, if there is a concave upward surface, then the force PL becomes, the pressure PL here becomes less than PG. As a result, you have got so called a capillary effect. So whenever there is a concave surface, concave upward surface, you will find rise in the capillary. If there is a convex upward surface, you will find that there is a decrease in the height because the pressure here becomes higher than pressure here. So this capillary effect has a lot of far-reaching consequences. For example, whenever there is a drying of material, you will find that there is a lot of cracking. So cracking of soil during drought. So whenever there is a drought, you can see the soil is cracked. Similarly, pent when get dried, if it is not properly made, you will find cracks in the pents. So one of the glaring example is this Mona Lisa, which is considered to be most beautiful women on the earth. But if you look at her painting very near, you will find that there are lots of cracks. So it doesn't look beautiful as you see from near. That happens. The other example I can give is the potato slice. When you dry it, you will find that it gradually shrinks to a very small dimensions from this initial dimension to last dimension. The cause is very simple to understand. They are porous materials. They are made up of capillaries which are very fine. So as long as water is on the surface of this capillary, no problem. Once water gets dried and it recedes into the capillaries, you will find that there is a pressure difference inside and outside. And this pressure can in very small capillaries. So if you see the previous slides, I have not explained. There is something like Young-Laplace equation which tells you the pressure difference. And that pressure difference is proportional to gamma and inversely proportional to radius. So if the radius of the capillary is very low, then the pressure here inside becomes so small that the capillaries try to shrink or compress. It compresses because the pressure becomes here very low. And if the pressure becomes sufficiently low, the network holding these capillaries collapses. So as a result, it starts shrinking, and shrinking creates cracks because it creates tension inside. So it creates shriveling when you allow it to shrink. So there is a collapse of network that causes this problem, and this is extremely important in drying of aerogels, because these aerogels have very fine pores. Aerogels are highly porous materials, and they are supposed to be very strong as well as porous. Their porosity goes to 98% to 99%. And there the diameters are 1 nanometers. So the pressure differential across the capillaries becomes so low that to keep their structure is extremely important. So they have to be dried extremely carefully. So how that drying is done? There are two, three things people do. One is to freeze it to form solids. Once it becomes solid, then you can sublime it. It's called freeze drying. So freeze drying can keep capillary structure intact. Other way you can do is you can change the surface characteristics so that this curvature can be changed. So if you can make curvature straight, then there will be no change. So it is the curvature that governs this, and therefore you can make, by changing the surface characteristic, you can change the drying characteristics. Another interesting aspect is called capillary origami. So the capillary forces can lift the material against gravity, and that is shown here. So this is a flower made up of polymer called PDMS. You put water on it and allow water to evaporate. Then you will find that because of capillary effect, the polymer get lifted, and it wraps around this water drop, and you get a nice structure that you get here. Similarly, here there is a triangle, then you get a pyramidal structure after the drop shrinks. So as drop shrinks, these petals get lifted. The similar thing happens when flower floating in water. So you can say the flower gets, the same thing, clamping of weight here. So we make the weight, air weight, then these capillary forces will make them clump together. Another effect which is caused by interfacial tension is what is known as Kelvin equation. Governing interface is Kelvin equation. So the activity of a interface becomes high if its radius becomes very small, and this is governed by what is known as Kelvin equation. So Kelvin equation tells you the activity of a surface compared to that of a flat surface. So as the radius decreases, the activity start increasing, and that is inversely proportional to radius of the drop. and the interfacial tension. So the vapor pressure is lower in small capillaries, and small crystals have higher solubility, and that causes what is known as Ostwald ripening. So if you see a crystal floating in water, and if they have size difference, then small crystals have higher solubility compared to large crystals. So they dissolve and large crystal grow, and you will finally get a single crystal. So whenever you have a suspension of soluble solids in a liquid, and if there is a size distribution, you will always find that they start growing. This suspension becomes unstable. When it grows, it starts settling. So this is called Ostwald ripening, and this is caused by the higher activity of small radius particles. Other is the condensation in the capillaries. So if you see a conical pore, and it's contacted with vapor, and you go on increasing the vapor pressure, you will find that the condensation start occurring in the smallest radius region. So pores start getting filled. So pore get filled at pressure lower than the vapor pressure, because this is a small radius. So vapor pressure here is lower than vapor pressure that you get at atmospheric pressure. And as you go on filling it, as you go on increasing the pressure in the gas, in the vapor, till it becomes vapor pressure. So when it becomes vapor pressure, it becomes very flat. So this is this particular property is used finding out pore size distribution. So by condensing the nitrogen, gases like nitrogen, you can find out pore size distribution using Kelvin equation. One of the important characteristic of interface is interfacial rheology. So if you consider, this is a soap film shown here. The soap film between two plates, and one plate is moving, other plate is fixed. You can find that velocity gradient developed, and you get what is known as a shear. So the force required to move will depend upon this velocity gradient. So the soap film act as if it is a fluid, but it is a two-dimensional fluid. So you can measure the rheology of interface by variety of techniques. But in liquids, you have only shear rheologies. But at interface, we can have another thing as dilatational rheology. That means you have a soap bubble which you try to dilate. You will find that require force to dilate it. So to increase the area of a film, you require certain force. This is known as dilatation, means changing the area. So area required force, so you have dilatational elasticity. And there are instruments to measure this interfacial rheology. One is a biconical interfacial rheometer, which oscillates at interface, and then you find out force. There is, of course, correction has to be made because part of it protrudes in the bulk of liquid. So it will also cause some effect of bulk. So you subtract that and you will get interfacial rheology. Other is what is called dynamic surface tensiometer. So you blow a bubble and find out force required for air to blow it. And that depends upon dilatational properties of this interface. It also depends upon how surfactant, if there are surfactant in the solution, how they come and adsorb, rate at which they adsorb will change the elasticity of surface. So you can find out adsorption characteristics of surfactant from that. So interfacial rheology has a problem because the bulk rheology also affects. So one of the instrument where bulk rheology can be almost eliminated is to use a needle which is kept at interface. So use a needle, small needle of very fine dimension, and then magnetically you oscillate it. So that way you get oscillating needle rheometer. I will not talk about this. So this by which you can remove the bulk interfaces. So this is a newly developed rheometer which is now in market. There is another very important consequence of interfacial tensions called Marangoni effect. The Marangoni effect comes because the interfacial tension is not same at all points on the surface. This happens because of the two reasons. The concentration of species, adsorbed species may be different, or temperature may be different. As a result, there is interfacial tension gradient which causes a force and which moves the molecules or which moves the interface, and which has a lot of consequence because they affect the bulk motion, because this interfacial motion affects bulk motion. One example I can show you is called a tear of wine. Those who are who drink wine and if they are observant, they find that if you see from top, you can see the droplets here. They are called tears of wine. This happens because of Marangoni effect. There is a film, so there is alcohol here at the corner, which has low surface tension because alcohol absorbs the surface, reducing surface tension. The alcohol which is present on the surface evaporates because it has low vapor pressure, and then the surface tension here increases because it is replaced by water. Water has much higher surface tension. As a result, you will find that it draws the liquid from below. So as a result, liquid start rising with time. After some time, liquid rises sufficiently high, but it loses all alcohol, so it forms water, so it tries to turn back, and you will see these tears because of that. Other important phenomena that you observed is called interfacial turbulence. So whenever a soluble material goes, say, from organic phase into aqueous phase, you will find that there is a difference in the concentration because mass transfer is not uniform at all points in interface. Because of interfacial concentration, there is interfacial tension gradient which causes motion, and this motion sometimes is so violent that you will get a good amount of mixing. So one of the way of creating mixing is to create situation where you have interfacial turbulence, which will cause very high rates of mass transfer. Mass transfer rates can increase 100-folds because of it, creation of interfacial turbulence. Another important characteristics caused by this Marangoni effect is called thermocapillary effect. It's called Rayleigh-Benard instability. So if you put a hot plate and cold plate and put a fluid here between the two and heat it, you will find circulation pattern. And this is a circulation pattern depicted. If you see from top, you will get this cellular formation. And this is called Benard Rayleigh instability. Rayleigh tried to explain this on the basis that there is a density gradient which causes this circulation. And to certain extent, he is correct. But it, the same phenomena was found when the lower plate was cold and upper plate was hot, which cannot be explained by the temperature, the buoyancy effect. So Pearson explained it by on the basis of temperature variation. So when the heating is done, there is a temperature variation which causes interfacial tension variation, and that causes fluid to flow, and that causes circulation pattern. So people have done modeling. Important is to quantitatively look at, find out when this happens, what is the size of cells, etc., etc., and this can be done by modeling. Another important phenomena that is observed is the scuba diver. When the scuba divers go inside water, what happens is the waves that because of temperature difference, you will get a what is known as thermocapillary effect, which is caused by interfacial tension variation. So you will get the small waves of the order of nanometer. So light which enters in gets scattered by these waves. As a result, the scuba diver does not get a sufficient amount of light to look at what is happening around, so it becomes dark. But if he spreads a small amount of oil, that dampens these waves. Once waves are dampened, you will see, he can see. So one of the trick that they do is just spread some small amount of water, very thin, small amount of oil, very thin film, and they can see what is going on. You can destabilize interface by electric field, and you can make lot of patterns out of it. So you take a patterned electrode and apply electric field, and you can get very small nano pattern, nano or micro patterns. And here is called a lithographic induced self-assembly, and here is the variety of self-assembly which are formed by electrical effect, by which you can destabilize the interface. Another destabilization occurs in electrospinning. So you have electric field applied between two electrodes and you draw the polymer and you can get very fine threads of the order of nanometers. I will talk about wetting and spreading. One of the important point here is, so wetting is governed by what is known as contact angle. So we have a contact angle with a solid placed on liquid, you will get a contact angle here theta, and at contact line the force balance is governed by what is known as Young's equation. This is the Young's equation which force balances, so component of gamma LV plus gamma SL becomes equal to gamma SV. So if this gamma SV is greater than this sum gamma LV plus gamma SL, you will get spreading, because even at theta equal to 0, this force is more than these two forces. So you will get always spreading. So for spreading, gamma SV should be much greater than gamma SL plus gamma LV. So this is very important when you are spreading pesticide on crop, because if the spreading is not very fast, the pesticide drops will fall out. As a result, you will lose a lot of pesticides. So people add certain amount of surfactant, certain materials to make it spread very fast. So increase the spreading coefficients. So this is a photograph which shows if you put just water on a leaf, because leaf is normally has waxy surface. So you will find that it doesn't allow drop to spread. But if you add a certain material, so these are commercial super spreader called Silhouette. You can see that water is spreading very finely on this, and about 2/30 seconds it spreads very fast, while this even after 6 seconds with ordinary water the drop is not yet spread. So you use certain silicon saline type of surfactant here, polysalines. You can make super hydrophobic surface, and so that they don't get dirty. So in fact, you make it so you make contact angle as large as possible, so the drop becomes spherical and it just rolls. So is there an example of a drop rolls on the surface? While it rolls, it takes away dirt. So this is another example where a drop rolls. So here the key factor is that not only your surface has to be hydrophobic, so it repels water, but you make it certain amount of roughness. So roughness enhances the contact angle. It increases the value of cos theta, so it increases the value of theta. So you make extremely fine roughness on the surface of fractal nature, and then you can get very high contact angle. So that is the so this is given by what is known as Wenzel equation. So cos theta rough, it becomes r times r is the degree of roughness. So you can make degree of roughness very high. So you can give a lots of example of super hydrophobic surface. So you will see that this is lotus leaf. So you see that lotus leaf has this fractal surface, which makes the contact angle to be very high. Then this is a water strider surface. As I told you, water strider not only has hydrophobic skin, but also has very fine fractal roughness on its surface. This is another example. This is a roughness which is purposely created of a particular geometry, with which you can make the drop very hydrophobic. Another exciting area which is coming up is called electrowetting or electrodewetting, as we call it. So if you take a drop and put it on a surface and apply electric field on it, the contact angle changes. For example, if you have 0 volt, the drop was like this. When you increase the potential, drop spreads. This happens because as you change the potential, surface energy changes. So surface energy is related to surface potential by what is known as Lippmann equation. So you can change the surface energy by changing electric potential and make the drop weight or not weight. You can change the frequency of this potential and create circulation inside drop. So the drop, so this can be used in microfluidics where you have small drops, you want to create circulation, you can use electric field. This is another experiment of microfluidics. For example, this liquid is flowing like this in a channel and there is air on both sides. So the fluid is going very straight. You apply electric field, then this surface becomes highly wetting. So fluid changes its course and try to stick to it and you will see that fluid is changing course. So you can take it from one side to other side by just applying electric field. In this is a microfluidic channel, and there are surfactants which by which you can change the surface properties. For example, you can use surfactants have head group and tail group. You must be familiar with surfactants nowadays. So the head group go in water and tail goes in oil, and as a result you make the interface compatible with each other, two fluids compatible with each other. So you have non-ionic surfactant where both the head and tail are, the head is actually non-ionic, or you can have ionic surfactant, or you have amphoteric where both positive negative charges exist. You can use mixed surfactant to reduce interfacial tension. So mixed surfactant goes between two surfactants, therefore they increase the density, adsorption density, and therefore they increase, reduce interfacial tension. So for making micro emulsion, mixed surfactants are commonly used. So these are a number of applications of surfactant. So these are common applications, I will not talk about them. One of the applications that you use is in enhanced oil recovery. For example, in enhanced oil recovery you use water to displace oil, but when water is used, you the water can go in and find out and produce what is known as viscous fingering. So it tried to go inside and then it breaks through from the other side. So instead of getting oil, you will get water. So you don't want this fingering to be formed, this undulation to be formed. So what you do is add certain amount of surfactant in it. So these undulations are suppressed and then whole thing goes, so water will be able to push the oil. So this is advantage of use of surfactant. One of the is pulmonary surfactants. They are very useful surfactants and they exist in every human being. So they are in the lungs and they cover the surface of alveoli. So what happens is while you breathe, the distance between the surfactant increases. So as a result, surface tension will increase. So as a result, it try to contract. So it gives you some kind of a resilience to this, so they don't inflate and break. So that is what it does. While you exhale, they get contracted and interfacial tension decreases, so exhalation becomes much easier. So that is advantage. In case of infants, there is a lack of surfactant where babies are premature, example. So they don't produce this lung surfactant. As a result, they can have respiratory failure. So you have to, so certain surfactants are injected into their lungs in order to make their breathing easier. So you can study the surfactant by which are adsorbed on the surface using number of instruments. So one is called Langmuir blodgett or Langmuir balance, where you have you spread a film on the surface and using a barrier you can contract or expand this film, and then you measure the pressure using a Wilhelmy plate. You can measure the pressure of this film and then you can see how much pressure is required to compress the film, and from that you can get film characteristic. For example, as you go on compressing, as you reduce the area, the pressure changes in different way and you get phase transition as you get in case of vapor to liquid to solid. and these characteristics can be studied by measuring vapor, the pressure versus area. So you go on contracting area and measure pressure. Other instrument that is used to measure thickness of the film is ellipsometry. So when the light falls on a film, so this is a film covering a solid surface. When the light falls on it, it gets elliptically polarized. Its polarization is different in different direction, and this ellipticity is measured to find out what is the thickness of this. You can also use IR, etc., to find out what are how the molecules are oriented on the surface. Another instrument to measure the weight of the film, because the weight is in nanograms. So to measure the weight, you use what is known as quartz crystal microbalance, which use a piezoelectric effect to measure the weight. It's a very sensitive balance which can measure nanogram of film material. So you take the film on this quartz crystal using this Langmuir blodgett. You take the lift the film, put it, and then put it inside this, and find out the weight. So you will know how much thickness or the how much weight this polymer. This surfactant has. There are polymeric surfactant of different geometries that you can have. So you have di-block surfactants, you have tri-block surfactant, comb type of surfactants, polymeric surfactant, and they can be effectively utilized, dendrimers, stars. So they can be used for drug delivery. For example, using polyelectrolyte, which are pH sensitive, you can make them shrink in certain condition and make them expand in some other conditions. You can use is in lubrications. For example, a polyelectrolyte, when it is attached on two surfaces, they will repel each other. As a result, the friction will reduce between the surface. You can use them for compatibilization of polymer blends. So use different polymers. A di-block polymer, one which is compatible with polymer A and polymer B, then you mix them with two polymers and blend the polymers, you will get interfaces which mix thoroughly with each other. So you will get a polymer blends which are compatible with each other. So you get very uniform mixture of the polymer. You can also change the wetting characteristic by adding polymers. When the drop falls, it many times recoil, because it is spread from top, it has got a lot of potential energy. So when it spreads, it recoils, and part of the pesticide is lost. So by adding a polymer, you don't allow it to retract. So it spreads but doesn't retract. So as a result, you can save the pesticide. So there are a number of research challenges in this area. So you can modify interface, surface energy, hydrophobicity, surface charge, electrical conductivity through adsorption. You can modulate interfacial rheology, measure it. Capillary Kelvin effect, you can exploit stabilization, destabilization of interface, rheology of concentrated surfactant solution and polymers, study and exploit it. There are also emulsions and micro emulsions. So the emulsions are used in drugs, for example, in this intravenous injections, you have emulsions. Instead of emulsion are water based. So you can have drug inside water, so you can inject it in blood without any problem. Milk is an emulsion. Cream is an emulsion. Sunscreen lotion is also an emulsion. Pesticides are again water, oil in water emulsion. And they use emulsifiers to use spread this pesticide. Emulsion paint is another example. So there are a variety of ways by which you can, the emulsion can get destabilized. So so you can have what is known as coalescence. So the coalescence of drops. The emulsion are basically unstable because they are. You are creating more area, therefore higher energy. So they try to minimize energy by minimizing area. So there are a variety of ways. One is coalescence, flocculation, or you can have what is known as creaming. You can have Ostwald ripening, as I have already explained to you. How much time is over? It's time. Okay. So ways in which you can break emulsion, there are a variety of ways emulsion break. So emulsion rheology is very important. So as you increase the concentration of the dispersed phase in emulsion, emulsion becomes first viscous, and when you goes to a close packed limit, it becomes more elastic, like solid like, it start becoming more and more elastic. So this is an emulsion which is in a rich this close packed region, and it is seen from microscope. You can see very fine droplets going touching each other. So this the volume fraction is 0.64 is called a limit, a packing limit, but you can get higher volume fraction by deforming this. So there are a number of ways of destabilizing emulsion or destabilizing or stabilizing emulsion using polymers or surfactants. For example, marangon, when two drops come each other, there is a shear which deforms the drop. So when drops are deformed, the surfactants are taken away, in the region between the drops are pushed apart. So there is a marangoni effect, because this interfacial tension get lowered and here interfacial tension get higher. So it doesn't allow the drops to deform. So as a result, it prevents coalescence, because when drops come together, they must deform until they touch each other, and then you have exchange of fluid and there is a coalescence. This is another way is what is known as steric stabilization. So polymer covers the surface very densely. When the two drops covered with polymer come to each other, come to, near each other, the polymer prevent there is what is known as repulsive interaction between these. Polymer doesn't interpenetrate each other, because there is entropy loss of interpenetration, and therefore it gets, you get what is known as steric stabilization. You can have electrostatic stabilization, that is you have got a charged polyelectrolyte which produces charge, so the two drops have polyelectrolyte with equal charge. So you have, they repel each other electrostatically, but you can destabilize by adding more salt, because salt will reduce the repulsion, because they reduce what is known as debye length. So they shrink the layer, double layer, where the repulsion will be strongest. So you have electrostatic destabilization. There is another destabilization which occurs called depletion coalescence. So when you are, you get a polymer here, the polymer which are which do not spread, but form coils. So they form large coils. So when two drops come to each other, they are displaced away from this. So as a result, you will have higher concentration of these coils outside and lower concentration in the region between the drops, and you get what is known as osmotic gradients. So there is osmosis of this solvent away from this. So drops come together and coalesce. This is important way is that you use electrostatic field to coalesce the droplets. The electrostatic field induces charge on droplets, and the charged droplets will attract each other, and then they coalesce with each other. And there are these electrostatic desalters are used in refineries. So in refineries, the crude oil contains salt, concentrated salt. If you don't remove that salt, it can corrode your downstream columns, because salt is highly corrosive. Therefore, this salt has to be removed before you start processing the crude. And what you do is you add water to the salt so that it gets diluted, and then you pass it through electrocoalesis. So you have large number of electrodes, you can apply large amount of voltage across these electrodes. So these get charged, they come together and coalesce, the drop become bigger, and then they settle. So so you have very large, huge electrostatic coalescer, hundreds of meter cube in the refineries. And nowadays people try to modulate the field so that you can get very compact electrocoalescers. So there is a trend towards making compact electrocoalescers. replacing the huge coalescers because they are very, very expensive. I think there is some, my whole, oh, this is, I don't know, while making this slide. So micro emulsion. So micro emulsions are thermodynamically stable. So what you do is there is the stability depend upon the interfacial energy. So what you do is, which depend upon interfacial tension. So you reduce interfacial tension almost to zero. You cannot reduce it to zero, but almost to zero, so that interfacial energy gets reduced. But when drop breaks, your entropy increases. So you will find that entropy generation balances the increase in the energy, because increase in energy is very small. So as a result, you will get a size of droplets where there is a balance of entropy and interfacial energy, and you get thermodynamically stable emulsion. And it is transparent because drop size is extremely low, so it doesn't scatter light, and as a result it becomes transparent material. So how do you do it? You add some small surfactant between two surfactants, so you get a dense surface. So these surfactants are normally alcohols or very small chain length surfactants. They are known as co-surfactants. By adding core surfactant, you can reduce the surface tension in micronewtons per meter. So these micro emulsions have lots of applications. They are thermodynamically stable, transparent, can both water and oil. So you can use water in oil emulsion, oil in water emulsions using this, and there are a number of application of it. And you can, by varying the water surfactant oil ratios, you can make different types of phases. One is bicontinuous, water in oil, oil in water emulsions. One of the application is drug delivery. For example, is the celecoxib drug is there, which is anti-inflammatory. So you can actually immobilize it in the this micro emulsions and use it in injections. There is one more application which I show, is the use of micro emulsion for conservation of cultural heritage. 5 minutes. Conservation of cultural heritage. So you use micro emulsion. So in past, people use acrylic and vinyl polymer to conserve the paintings. So they use a lot of this polymer on the painting, but that has spoiled because this polymer get degraded over time and it has spoiled all the paintings. So now the new technique is to remove this polymer. So they have extra work to remove this polymer without spoiling the painting further. So they use micro emulsions. The advantage of micro emulsion is that it is water based. So it is water, oil in water emulsion. So water comes in contact with painting. The solvent doesn't come direct in contact with painting. A solvent comes in contact with painting, it can dissolve the polymer, but it can spread it in the rest of the painting, which is very bad. So you use water as a base, but you have micro emulsion, because micro emulsion droplets have very large surface area, they can scavenge this polymer inside, and therefore you can remove this polymer and restore the painting. For example, this is a painting before treatment with micro emulsion. This is a treatment after micro emulsion, and this patch you can see is used as a sort of a this thing. So you can see this restoration of this, and what is done is you put it inside a poultice, this micro emulsion, that put it, stick it on your painting. So there's a lot of research challenge to make stable emulsion with high fraction, how to break emulsion, rheology of emulsion in a variety of stress field, stabilization and destabilization of emulsion and suspension. The foam is third thing which I'll try to finish. There are different types of foams. For example, milk on cappuccino is, you will see this foam. There are polystyrene foam, there is a foam which are metallic foams. The bread is a foam, example of foam, the polyurethane foam used as insulators. There are two types of foam, one is closed cell and open cell, they have different properties. For example, closed cell, open cell foam is a poor insulator, not as good insulator as closed cell, because air can flow through it and there is a convective flow can happens, but closed cell foams are much more better insulator. You can have foam containing fillers also. So applications are, one is a crumple zone. So in many cars you have these foams which are embedded in the front part. When there is a collision, this foam will take the shocks. So they are known as crumple zones. They get crumpled and take the shock. Froth flotation is one example where you use a foam. So you use air to foam it, and the particle get attached at air water interface and they get floated. Another is foam fractionation, which is very important. So you want to remove small amount of valuable material like protein from surface, you can use foam fractionation. You can make a foam, the materials which are surface active get concentrated on the foam surface and then it gets separated. Another is foam assisted enhanced oil recovery. So we use ordinary carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide is used for recovery of oil. If you use ordinary carbon dioxide, you will find that it forms another layer. So it passes along with the oil and water. But you make a foam out of it. It forms a foam of water, and this foam spreads over entire area of cross section, and then it able to push the whole oil water interface. So you will get much higher efficiency water recovery. The another important area is to get predict geometry of foam. What kind of foam geometry you have? So the foam is, I will not cover this, you can see it from my slides. I will talk about stability of foams. So stability of foam is very important, because foam is stable. You want to make very stable liquid foam air. So the foam get destabilized because there is, the foam has borders known as plateau borders. So so the plateau borders have curvature which is concave outward. So the pressure here is lower, so it sucks liquid from all sides. So plateau borders are the places where fluid gets drained. So you can make the drainage rate slow by adding some surfactant on this, surfactant which are highly elastic, which don't allow, because when the fluid flows, it will try to stretch the surface. So if we prevent this stretching, you can reduce the foam drainage. So you can increase the foam by adding some polymers in the foam. You can stabilize the foam. You can destabilize the foam by adding particles or very small drops. So these particles will go through the foam and break the foam, and therefore, or you can use particles to stabilize the foam. The particle will stay and strengthen the foam. So it depends upon how you use this particle, whether they are hydrophilic or hydrophobic. If they are hydrophilic, they will stay inside. If they are hydrophobic, they will cross through and break. Or you can use oils to destabilize. So there are a number of research challenges here. To relate microstructure of foam and its mechanical properties, what should be the microstructure yield desired property? That is also very important. There is a reverse problem. Stability of gas liquid foams, how you make them stable, and the rheology of foams is also very important. So if I look at entire area of surface interfacial science, there is a huge research potential. So there is a large pool of top researchers working in this area. So you can make your own mark by doing high quality research in this area. With that, I stop. So how much time did I exceed?
Many thanks, Professor Juvekar, for excellent lecture on interfacial science. I would request my colleagues here, Professor A.K. Suresh and Professor Mahesh Thirumkudlu, to come on the dais. Begin with, I'll request both of them to say shortly about their research. We'll start with Professor Mahesh. And
thank you, Sachin. So I'm Mahesh Thirumkudlu. I work in two different areas. One is in fluid mechanics and the other is colloids and interfaces. So the kind of problems that I work on, which is related to the interfacial sciences, is essentially the automation problem, That is, I try and look at how starting with a thin sheet of liquid, you can break it up into tiny droplets. And of course, this has many applications, as you can imagine. It has application in combustion, because you would like to understand how to get a desired distribution of a fuel so that you can have optimum combustion. It has applications in biomedical devices like nasal sprays, etc. It has application in spray painting or spray drying and so on and so forth. And the kind of work we do in this problem in our research group involves both experiments where we produce these thin liquid sheets. We excite these thin liquid sheets with acoustics or any other external forces. And then using high-speed cameras and lasers, we look at the process of breakup of these thin liquid sheets into droplets. We also do theory in terms of coming out with analytical expressions to determine the breakup of these thin liquid sheets. We try and predict what the drop size distribution should be. We also do some amount of computational fluid dynamics where we try and simulate this process. Okay. The funding for this problem has come from ISRO, that is Indian Space Research Organization, because it has some application in the combustion involved in liquid propulsion rocket engines. We had some funding from the Indo-French Research Council because of some interest also again in looking at the breakup process. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Suresh. I will be addressing you again on Friday morning, and therefore I'll tell you more about my research areas at that time. My excuse for being here on this day is that part of our work relates to reactions at or near interfaces, and therefore some understanding of interfacial phenomena becomes necessary in trying to understand these reactions. These are polymerization reactions which, as I said, take place, which are conducted near the interface, and they form a film, a polymeric film, at the interface itself. And these kinds of films can be used for various purposes. They are used in coating droplets which are containing active principles like enzymes or pesticides or herbicides, and encapsulating them in this kind of a polymeric film. So this kind of micro encapsulation is one application we have been looking at. The other application of the same type of reaction, that is an interfacial polymerization reaction, is in making membranes for various separation duties. For example, reverse osmosis membranes have a very thin polyamide layer which is produced by this kind of a reaction. And so when we apply these reactions to these various situations like membrane formation and micro encapsulation and so on, we need to venture out of the field of reaction engineering a little bit, understand the structure of the films that we form, how those structures can be modified, what influence does the structure have on the functional behavior of the polymeric films, and so on and so forth. So in that connection, we get into some aspects on the material side of things, that is characterizing surfaces, characterizing films, and relating those characteristics to the film properties, and modifying those films by incorporation of particulate matter on the nanoscale, and understanding the mechanisms that drive changes in properties when we do these kinds of things, and so on and so forth. In the field of reaction engineering, which I will anyway talk to you in greater detail on Friday, we look at various multiphase systems. Mostly our interest is in systems where there is a coupling between transport phenomena and reaction kinetics. So these usually involve multiphase contacting and multiphase reactions. So we look at several gas-liquid systems, several liquid-liquid systems, several solid-solid systems and gas-solid systems and so on, and try to use these kinds of interactions between transport and reaction to our advantage in the sense of improving rates and selectivities in various situations of industrial interest. Thank you.
We work in the area of use of electric field for modulating interfaces. and also in the area of emulsions. So in the area of electric field, we myself and Rochish are working on these electrocoalescence, how to induce electrocoalescence, how drop deform, so and how drop deform when they are covered with certain films. So you can make polymeric film and look at the deformation of this film of the drop, and then from that predict. For example, you are conducting an interfacial reaction on a drop surface. What you can do is you can study the kinetics of that reaction by just studying the drop deformation under interface. So as the polymer gets built up, the film become more elastic. So its deformation start decreasing for the same electric field. So you can then predict the kinetics of deposition from studying this. Professor Rochish is also studying the bilayer, how the bilayer react to electric field. Bilayer and vesicles react to electric field by application of electric field. He does that. We are studying what is known as liquid emulsion membranes, in which we make emulsion inside emulsion. So we get a triple emulsion. So you have water in oil emulsion, which is prepared, and then this emulsion is again dispersed in water. So you have water, oil, and water. And you make this oil liquid very thin, so it acts as a membrane, separating two water phases. So you have a membrane separating two water phases. So the application of this liquid emulsion membrane is that you can transport you can extract a components in the water phase into oil phase using certain carrier, and then you inside the water inside phase, which is again a water phase, you can deposit this material and you can thereby concentrate this material. So what happens, this carrier picks up the material, deposit it internally, again gets freed. So you add certain reagent inside inside phase so that the equilibrium gets shifted and that the material gets deposited inside the field, and carrier gets freed, again picks up the material. So therefore you can enrich the material at very low concentration outside. You can enrich it by order of 100 or even 1000 times. So this is advantage. So there the problem lies in stabilizing this emulsion, because if you have enriched in inner phase, if it leaks out, then whatever effort you have used for enrichment is completely lost. So you have to have extremely stable emulsion. And you are shearing the whole thing, so it should be shear stable. So that is the problem which we try to analyze, and we try to model the whole system. See, co-surfactant is a different kind of surfactant from the main surfactant. For example, main surfactant is a polyelectrolyte. What happens is it is an ionic surfactant, for example. So what happens is it reduces interfacial tension, but it cannot reduce it to a very low value because there is a repulsion between the head groups. So the distance between the two adjacent molecules cannot come very near each other. So the adsorption of this surfactant is sparse because of the head group repulsion. So one way to prevent it is to add salt so that head group repulsion reduces. In addition, you can use a co-surfactant which is non-ionic, a very small co-surfactant, which is a small in size so that it sits in between the two and therefore allows increase in the adsorption density on the surface. And as adsorption density increases, you will find that the interfacial tension goes down. So you are ultimately your aim of co-surfactant is to allow higher density so that your interfacial tension goes down below 1 millinewton, even go to 1 micronewton. By choosing that co-surfactant, you can make a very compact layer, adsorb layer. So that is what is the principle behind using co-surfactant. water solvent, actually the polymer, when you dissolve it in a solvent, there are two forces which are one is the interaction between the solvent and a polymer. So if interaction between solvent and polymer is, so polymer likes the solvent, or solvent likes the polymer, then polymer will try to open up. So polymer will try to open up and so that its entropy becomes very high. So open up polymer will have very high entropy. So it tried to maximize entropy by opening up. So this is called a good solvent. Then we call the solvent as a good solvent. If the bad solvent means you have a very bad solvent means it doesn't like the polymer, then polymer will close and probably precipitate out from the solvent. So bad solvent, very bad solvent can even precipitate the solvent. Theta solvent lie exactly in between. So there is a balance of entropy and enthalpy, you can say. Enthalpy is the interaction. So when there is a perfect balance between these two, the solvent is called theta solvent. So it, polymer is still soluble, it doesn't come out, but it forms a coiled structure. So you can use what is known as the polymer-polymer interaction. For example, polymer-polymer interaction and polymer-solvent interaction become identical. So the polymer doesn't come very near each other. So such a polymer in theta solvent act as if it is a very flexible polymer. So its distribution of this thing is so-called normal distribution. So if you see the special distribution of the segments, it forms a normal distribution. So it is actually a perfect linear spring. So theta solvent has a specific property which makes it attractive for modeling these polymers.
Oswald Reitman.
So it is based on what is known as the interfacial energy, or the energy, interfacial energy becomes higher and higher as the particle diameter decreases. So because of the curvature, this happens because of the curvature. So you are actually bending the whole molecule. So it becomes strained. As a result, you will get higher surface energy. Such molecules try to reduce their surface energy by dissolving in the solvent. So therefore, higher surface energy will increase the solubility. So very fine particles have higher solubility in the solvent compared to a large particle because it has a lower curvature. So as a result, if you have a distribution of particle size, and if you take a mixture of crystal with different sizes, then what happens is because the small particles have higher solubility, they will start dissolving, and because the large particles have lower solubility, it try to deposit. So there is a driving force from smaller particle size to larger particle size. So smaller particles dissolve and deposit on larger particles which have lower surface energy. As a result, smaller particles will start dissolving and larger particles will start growing. So this is known as Oswald ripening.
But sir, what is the diameter for dissolving? What should be the dimension?
See, the rate at which they dissolve will depend upon diameter because this driving force. So if there is a difference in particle diameter, you can calculate the driving force for this. So if the particle diameter difference is very large, then the driving force for dissolution become very high.
The particles which are getting dissolved.
So all size particle dissolve, but the rate becomes slower. So you have different particle size. So very small particle will dissolve very fast because their surface energy is very high. Their solubility become much higher. So they will dissolve much faster. You can calculate surface energy and then calculate solubility, and from that you can calculate driving force. It's very simple to calculate from that. But smaller particles dissolve faster. If there is a disparity in size, and if you keep it for sufficiently long time, then you always get Oswald ripening. It will be slow process, but will always happen.
Sir,
biosurfactant?
Well, I'm not an expert in biosurfactant, but one of the things that I know is when a baby is born, you know, there are surfactants in the lungs. And so when the baby is actually born, the lung is supposed to expand so that it starts breathing. One of the diseases
may be missing this particular surfactant. And so what comes to my mind is that is a biosurfactant, and therefore there are surfactants that are developed which can be immediately injected into the baby or introduced into the lungs so that the lungs actually expand as soon as they. So that is one simple example that I know of a biosurfactant. I don't remember the name of the surfactant, but if you Google, you will know that.
You
give the slide.
Yeah. It's taken from cow's liver or something. Minced liver of cows. It's called sorbenta, which is used as a biosurfactant. Other thing is proteins. Proteins are used as surfactant in food stabilization of food emulsion. Proteins are normally
lipids
used.
Lipids are also used.
Proteins
so
are
the
also
cell
used.
Of your body is the cell walls are all made of lipids. So
yes.
That's all.
Phospholipid, for example, lecithin. Lecithin is a very widely used in food stabilizing food emulsions, which is a phospholipid.
So, do these stickers affect the efficiency of pesticides?
No, this is news to me.
No, they are not stickers.
I don't know.
So, why don't you explain the process spreading so that I think that's.
No, he is talking about some. What is sticker means what? This is a sticker like this?
No,
you are talking about spreader.
So
I have explained because. When you spray liquid, it tries to rebound because it has very high potential. It is spread from at energy because you put at a force. So they have very high velocity as they strike. When they strike, they spread, but they recoil and then they fall off. So one way is to prevent this recoil. So there are different. So you add some small amount of polymer into it. So it changes many properties. For example, they said they increase extensional viscosity of the polymer, so it doesn't recoil, or it can change interfacial properties also. They can change interfacial increase interfacial elasticity, so that it doesn't recoil. See, micro emulsions, these are not, these need not be polymers. These are ordinary surfactant. Correct. Not necessary. You can make, as long as you make these micro emulsion need not be done with polymers. You can use normal surfactant with co-surfactant. You can make polymers can also be used. But there are a variety of ways you can make a microemulsion. There is no specific microemulsion used for the drug which you mentioned.